welcome each and every person as we continue this Easter season, this celebration of the resurrection of Jesus and the hope of resurrection in our lives as individuals, as communities, and indeed as all of God's beloved creation. It is actually the Sunday closest to Earth Day, so you'll notice a little bit of a Earth theme weaving through our liturgy today. It's also what's known as Good Shepherd Sunday, which is readings that focus around the image of Christ or Jesus or God as a shepherd, a very rich tradition, which we'll only touch on the depth of today in our music and our liturgy. So please do settle in for that ride. It is also a day that I come to personally with beautiful mixed emotions. One of our sojourners, co-sojourners for the last 8 years, almost 8 years, I think you said in your note, is taking leave from us. I like the term taking leave because it leaves it open-ended. But and I won't say much more about that. We are a community that does some things really well, other things we trip through and whatever, but I think we send people pretty well usually, and we pray them off. And so we'll be doing that just before the blessing today, praying Catherine into the next steps of her spiritual journey. And we did put a blog post out, so if you're connected to us on social media, you will have seen her letter. We haven't sent out our MailChimp yet, so we will send out that, and you'll hear a bit more of the story of what's happening there in the day or two to come. In terms of announcements, not too much new. I think everything should be on the back of your leaflet. We are restarting our communion service, our Eucharist at our place, which is happening now Tuesdays at 11. We had a lovely unexpected flow of people on Monday, last Monday, into our morning prayer with Centering Prayer Sit, and please do come on out if you are interested in that kind of contemplative, prayerful expression of faith, if you're called into that. We had a beautiful concert in here last night, about 150 folks watching the great Welsh singer-songwriter Martin Joseph, and so the musicality of the place continues to flow, and we give thanks to all who were part of that and who helped out with that and who were present for that. I think that's all I'm going to say in terms of announcements, and we'll just kind of let things flow from here. I will, as we always do, recall and remember and rename the fact that we are worshiping, praying, playing on stolen land, on land which was taken with coercion from the Songhees and Esquimalt nations, the Lekwungen peoples. As a community, we continue to ask questions of ourselves, of each other, of our wider communities, our neighborhood, our denominations, what reparation and reconciliation and justice means as we continue to journey along that way. So we give thanks, Hashkasiem, for the folks who have stewarded this earth. I've often been told, don't do a land acknowledgement from Indigenous people, don't do a land acknowledgement without referring to the earth. And of course, it's Earth Sunday. So we give thanks for the people, but also for the earth, which has sustained them and continues to sustain us all. With all of that, let's just take a moment to gather our breath, prepare our hearts for worship, come into this place. We praise you, O God, brooding hen, nurturing mother, suffering servant, good shepherd. And together we say, We delight in this world we call home, its many mysteries and ever-evolving goodness. You have created us in your own image and fashioned us from the sweet, sweet soil of the earth. You continue to make us, even when we don't know what to make of ourselves. God of Easter morning, we see glimpses of your risen life in all that you have made. Sharpen our vision and open our clenched hands that creation may be made whole. O divine word whose creating never ceases, bless us that we may simply belong.
O God of earth, our Eden, our hope, may our worship bring us into harmony with all.
Let us pray. Holy One, heart of creation, you know and call us each by name. We come together to celebrate your creation, the beautiful streams that surround us and that I understand are actually under our feet and that provide us with food and water, the beauty of spring blooms, the wonder of the hummingbird's wings, and the growing light of lengthening days. Open our hearts to the cries of the whole family of creation, that we may be empowered to act in love for all. For you are the good shepherd who leads us toward green pastures.
Stand in body or in spirit as we sing our first hymn, All Hail the Power of Jesus' Name.
Children of all ages, people of all ages are also welcome to set the table with the symbols of our faith at the back.
Shepherd is a wonder in contrapposto, an artist mapping the Serengeti with kingdom lines. A good shepherd angles a lion's eye, traps gazelles in dry fields, copies a cheetah's spots one leg at a time. A good shepherd does not give you stones when you ask for toast, does not ask you to work without a burning bush, but owns a gate, uses a gate, pulls the weeds and leaves the wheat on an altar of choices. A good shepherd is a prince of peace when terror finds its full echo, a creator in the wild where a predator, providentially, becomes prey.
Hallelujah.
Hear the good news of Jesus Christ.
Thanks be to God.
A reading from the Gospel of John, chapter 10, verses 11 to 18. Jesus said, "I am the good shepherd. The shepherd lays down their life for the sheep. The hired hand, who is not the shepherd and does not own the sheep, sees the wolf coming and leaves the sheep and runs away, and the wolf snatches them and scatters them. The hired hand runs away because a hired hand does not care for the sheep. But I am the good shepherd. I know my own, and my own know me, just as my Abba knows me, and I know my Abba. And I lay down my life for the sheep. I have other sheep that do not belong to this fold. I must bring them also, and they will listen to my voice. So there will be one flock, one shepherd. For this reason, my Abba loves me, because I lay down my life in order to take it up again. No one takes it from me, but I lay it down of my own accord. I have power to lay it down, and I have power to take it up again. I have received this command from my Abba." The Gospel of the Christ.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. Protect you through the storm. May God bring you home rejoicing at the wonders God has shown you. Mama hen bring you rejoicing once again into our doors. Amen. Please be seated. So a few weeks back, I received a text from a fellow sojourner, an acquaintance, who wanted to chat with me about spiritual matters. And this particular person is not a person of the church, not a Jesus follower, but is such a deeply beautiful, wonderful, spiritual person. And as we talked, they told me that they were more than comfortable with the idea of God as a metaphor, the notion of God within us. And I'm okay with that too, actually. But then they asked me, with this beautiful, honest vulnerability, what makes me, or some of us here, not presuming all of us, but what makes some of us believe in a God who's actually more than a metaphor, more than something that is good within us, who is actually a being that cares about us in some way, for us. Throughout Lent, we drew on the 12 steps in our worship. We spoke of relenting control, and I think it's great that we just keep coming back to it, because I think it's something we got to come back to our whole life. That is to admit our powerlessness and to audaciously believe that maybe there is just some higher power greater than ourselves that can restore us to our deepest humanity. I think that Jesus' teaching today of the good shepherd speaks to that question that that person brought to me. And I think it actually kind of subtly reveals something so powerful about the very nature of this God who we gather here to worship. I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down their life for their sheep, Jesus teaches. Now, I don't know about you, but the images of the good shepherd that are out there, though well-intentioned, kind of leave me a little bit cold. Just Google it. Google good shepherd. With all due respect, you'll find something like these.
There they are.
You know this vibe, right? Again, with all due respect, blonde, wavy-haired Jesus in some idyllic countryside, looks like England usually, just chilling with his sweet little white baby lambs, often wrapped around his shoulders. And I want to respect that. I mean, I'm playing with it, but there's value in that image too. But I think we're missing something really, really, really important here. And then there's this word good in Good Shepherd. Now, I don't know about you, and maybe it's just the English, but it feels, well, just a little bit nice, safe. Feels a little bit bland or trite, even. So as I was kind of going through the commentaries this week, I was heartened to hear that the word good here, the Greek word kalos, can equally be translated as beautiful. Sort of inner and outward, physical and deep inner beauty. That is something different, I think. The beautiful shepherd. The beautiful shepherd. I am the beautiful shepherd. I love that. Now, the context of today's gospel reading is actually one of sheer danger. This is not the quaint pastoral countryside with lazy grazing sheep. Jesus has provoked the religious and political powers of his time. Sound familiar? He is walking a path toward a Roman cross. His followers have been compromised in their safety. And right after this passage, the religious folks will actually pick up stones in anger to want to kill him, to charge him with blasphemy, which the punishment at the time was death. Even in the song which we just sung, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want," it's a similar context. Yes, we are led to still waters, but this is in the midst of the bleak night, the very shadow of death itself. And so into that bleakness, I believe, Jesus comes in beauty in the midst of all the precarity that we hear about. He says, "I am the beautiful shepherd. I know my own, and my own know me." Just as the Abba, which has this connotation of daddy. Sweet, loving parent. Just as my Abba, my Amma knows me, and I know my Abba. So let's stop here, because yes, Jesus is invoking divine protection. And thinking again of my friend's question about God, I admit that I do need that. I do need a power greater than myself that is not just myself. I know we don't all necessarily agree with that, but that's kind of where I find myself. But it's easy to skim over that line, just as my daddy knows me and I know my daddy, and miss something very important. And again, the image that I often have in my mind if I think of a shepherd is one of a kind of strong, usually male, protecting, steering, correcting authority figure. If you were to close your eyes and think of a shepherd, maybe I've ruined it for you, what is it that you first imagine? Maybe you can think outside the box. That's at least what it is for me. Maybe closer to those images or that Sunday school flannel board pictures that I would like to admit. But it's interesting because in Christian theology, at least kind of the classical articulations of it, the first two persons of the Trinity, the Father and the Son in traditional language, are depicted as co-equal. So for Jesus to say, "I know my sheep and they know me," just as my Abba, my daddy, and my co-equal in the Trinity, we know each other in that same way, is pretty darn bold, to say the least. It's no wonder that the religious types wanted to stone him for blasphemy. See, I think that Jesus is actually suggesting something truly radical, that God is, yes, a king, one beyond us to whom angels prostrate fall, as we sang in our opening hymn. I'm glad you suggested that one, Catherine. I got to slip it in here. Powerful and awe-inspiring and mightily ruling. But this shepherd God is at once one who offers friendship. This is a God who cares for us with an unrelenting love like a good parent. This is a relationship of mutuality, of intimacy, of vulnerability, like a parent and a child, or like two lovers, as our mystics might suggest. And I think that we religious leaders, like the religious leaders of Jesus' day, sometimes do like to keep God way out there, high in the sky, distant, above and beyond us, because it puts us too as God's supposed spokespeople on a similar pedestal. But I love in this very story of the shepherd, Jesus shows us something very different. This is the God who shares in our humanity, who washes feet, who calls us friends, who is a lover, who would give up their very life for us. And then on this Earth Day, there is the sheep, the poor sheep. Now, my view of sheep is often of these mindless beasts needing to be guided, almost kind of stupid, bleeding creatures. Again, I think it's important on this Sunday closest to Earth Day that we challenge that mythology. Sheep, I'm told, are deeply, deeply intelligent. They have nuanced emotions. The BCSPCA tells me that sheep can recognize up to 50 other sheep faces and remember them for 2 years, which frankly is a heck of a lot better than me. I can't remember the names of the folks that I met this morning. Sheep can remember how to navigate complex mazes. Sheep can experience a wide range of emotions to feel afraid, angry, bored, sad, and happy. And not only can they feel basic emotions, but their feelings can be very complex. They can even be, get this, pessimists or optimists. I don't know how they do these studies, but I think it's helpful, actually, to counter that image that we are mindless followers of Jesus, or that we have no agency, or that we just languishly, listlessly are wrapped around the good shepherd's neck with that wavy hair. Yes, to go back to my conversation with my friend, I do maintain that we desperately need a shepherd. Again, in that language of AA, someone beyond us, a higher power who we can admit our powerlessness to. But we are also at the same time not automatons who bleed around and have no mind or will of our own. And sometimes I think it's important to name that, because sometimes that's how that image gets played out. Just go with the crowd, go with the flow. But there's something more nuanced in nature about the sheep. I love what this story says about God and about us. But for me, the real nugget actually comes next, the heart of this teaching where Jesus says, "And I lay down my life for my sheep." Probably not surprising to those of us who are parents, that sentiment. What would you do if harm was coming to something you loved so dearly? It's a difficult question without an easy answer. A few chapters later in the gospel, Jesus actually underlines what he's saying here. He says, "This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you." You hear that mutuality again in the language, right? "Love one another as I have loved you. No one has greater love than this, to lay down one's life for one's friends." He goes on to say, "You are my friends. You are my friends. I don't call you servants any longer, because the servant does not know what the master is doing, but I have called you friends." And then we flip over to one of the other gospels. In Luke's gospel, also written in a time of precarity, Jesus uses another image of himself, and I think it's nice to put these two images together. This one is a feminine image, also drawn from the natural world. Here Jesus depicts himself as the mama hen, weeping over the state of God's people. "How often have I desired to gather your children together as a hen gathers her brood under her wings, and yet you were not willing," Jesus says. And And I'm not actually changing the genders there. That's exactly what he says in the translation. How often have I desired to gather your children as a hen gathers her brood under her wings, and you were not willing. This image nicely rounds out the shepherd one for me. It gives us this sweet image of Jesus, who God is for us and with us and friends with us. The context of Jesus calling himself a good shepherd and a mother hen, calling us into this shelter and friendship and into those protecting wings, these for me are beautiful, important, and necessary images drawn from our relationship with nature, from the non-human created order. And so to my conversation and fellow sojourners' questions about the nature of God, I don't pretend to have easy, clean answers. There's a lot of complexities. If Jesus is our friend, what about this, this, and this? If Jesus is our lover, what about this, this, and this? This is the stuff that we try and work out in our lives. But I just want to start by saying that yes, our faith does speak of the cosmic Christ, of God who is truth, love, beauty, and justice, God who is within each of us. Good, good, that is part of our tradition. But it is also part of our tradition, and I think it's a scandalous part, because we claim that God is our beautiful shepherd, protects and holds us under the shelter of her wings, who sits with us in weeping uncertainty, even going after the one lost sheep, as another one of our sacred stories tells us. In laying down one's life for a friend, our good shepherd, our mama hen, sets a pattern for those of us who are people of privilege, which is most of us, to share. It's what Matt spoke of last week, that self-giving love of a God who calls us friend, who through divine call sees us as lovers, who washes our feet, and who gives up their own life and privilege and calls us to do the same. This, to me, is so countercultural in a culture and in so many cultures and subcultures that call us to power over, to acquiring more stuff, to building up our own empires and protecting our egos. And a caution, lest this teaching that I'm saying gets used to justify suffering and death by the victims of oppression, again, we turn back to the teaching of Jesus, where he says, I lay this down of my own accord. I have the power to lay it down, and I have the power to take it up again. As one writer notes, Jesus is not a powerless victim. Jesus is God who has chosen the vulnerability, the fragility, and the weakness of human existence. This is not a passage encouraging the sheep to accept their place on sacrificial tables, no way. It's a passage that affirms the power of the beautiful shepherd to resist those who seek to devour the sheep. The images of the wolves, maybe not a helpful image. Wolves got demonized, but no one goes. With the predators and oppressors cutting into our faith, when we live in the grandeur and carnage of these days, as Martin Joseph sang right here last night, leaving us broken with the burden of ambivalence, as our beautiful Catherine wrote in her goodbye letter to us. Sometimes there's little more than we can do but sing in the words of the pioneer of African American gospel, Reverend Thomas A. Dorsey, precious Lord, take my hand, lead me on, let me stand, I'm tired, I'm weak, and I'm worn. I think it's helpful for me to know that someone, I don't pretend to even know the depths of what and who they are, but there's something that actually hears those cries. Hear my cry, hear my call, hold my hand when I fall. There's something powerful about seeking shelter in the arms of our mama hen, to take the care of our beautiful shepherd who will never, ever let us down. To know of this love and care and friendship, this protection, and to find healing and joy and wonder and abundance even in dangerous and precarious and violent times that we live in. This is my prayer for all of us today. This is my prayer. And it's a prayer I pray in the name of Abba, Ama God, the beautiful shepherd, the mama hen, and the Holy Spirit, who is our comforter. Amen.
Invite you again to rise in body or in spirit as we affirm the ancient story of our faith.
I believe in God, the
of the people were influenced and inspired by Cole Arthur Riley, M. Jade Kaiser, and Richard Einersden. O God, whose people have called you by so many different names, your people have called you Yahweh, they have called you Elohim, they have also called you Father. We thank you that somehow the metaphor of shepherd also became such a powerful description for you because it evokes feelings of calm, security, and gentleness within us. It frees us to meet you otherwise, away from the constructs of gender, of patriarchy, and hierarchical power. We thank you that you also sent us Jesus, the good shepherd, that we might have life and have it abundantly. Make us faithful followers of the good shepherd. When we stray, keep us from serious danger and lead us gently back to you. Lead us to the places in life where there is enough calm and quiet that we find renewal, but provide us enough challenge to bring out the best in us. We give thanks for your voice, that when we stop to listen, we are filled with a knowing of what we need to deepen our relationship with you. We give thanks for our sister Catherine, who seeks to find healing from wounds of institutional church. We pray that she feels seen and known by us. May her path be healing and life-giving, opening space for more joy in her life and liberating her time so she can continue to be a reflection of your grace. And be with us as we work hard to resist the wounds, the ways that the institutional church continues to wound people of color, queer people, people in the margins. I think we're called to that. You are a God of skinned knees, bruised egos, grieving hearts, pain-filled bodies, and damaged souls. We've all been hit hard here and there, and some far more than others. And then life goes on its way until the next bump, fall, or smackdown, and we pick ourselves up, dust ourselves off, and life goes on again. In those places of life where we become fearful and anxious, be with us, keep us safe from danger. Lead us through the valleys of the deep shadows. As long as there is breath within us, we will try to remember to turn to you in those inevitable places. But God, if you could, give us a nudge now and then. Sometimes we need a shove to get ourselves out of the dark. God of every ache, help us to befriend our bodies. We confess it is easy to turn against them as the source of our trouble. Awaken a compassion, a tenderness towards the parts of us that are changing and hurting. With every ailing and unseen thing, guide us toward those capable of listening and perceiving when we are not okay, that we won't feel pressure to pretend or apologize or explain, but to exist in the truth of what we need. God of the land that cries out. I'm just going to pause for a second because yesterday this downtown area was filled with ambulance sounds. I must have heard 8 ambulances in the period of an hour, and I just want to hold up the community in the street and the people who are not safe from drug supply. God of every ache. Oh, sorry, I already said that. God of the land that cries out, these lands that ache as we do. We confess that we have failed these lands and waters. We have bowed down to the convenience of machines and taken pleasure in our overconsumption. Grant us courage to name the atrocities of climate degradation, even when it implicates our daily habits. Show us, too, that our mourning is not just about how we treat creation, but the loss we face in failing to listen to it. For what elder do we have older than the clouds, the tides, or the wind in the leaves? Spirit of spring emerging, we give thanks for the sunshine and the blossoms that line the streets of our neighborhoods, for the quetzal waiting to blanket the fields in Meagan. As we behold the glory, we are reminded that yours is a trustworthy hope. You are the whispered promise, humble and patient of what is carefully held and hidden in the depths, just waiting for its right time to buzz, bustle, and blossom us to life again. Amen.
Let us together face the empty cross and take a moment in silence before the God of unending mercy and love, to confess both the wrongs we have done, the things we have left undone, and those wounds in need of healing. Good Shepherd, draw you in and cleanse you from your sins, that you may walk in the peace of the risen Christ. Jesus Christ, our Lord. invite you to rise in body or in spirit. Beloved community, the peace of the beautiful shepherd be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us share that peace with one another.
Again, sing about the Good Shepherd, the offertory, the King of Love, the Shepherd is on page 5. Shepherd of the sheep, our mother hen. Enshroud us in your divine care and love. Feed us at this, the table of beauty, until the day comes and you gather us into your arms of mercy.
The Lord Scattered across this land, then gathered and made one in this bread. So may your people, scattered to the ends of the earth, be gathered and made one in your love. Amen.
As beloved children of a loving parent, we pray as Jesus taught us. Our Mother, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom, power, and glory, forever and ever. These are the gifts of God for the people of God, given for the life of the world. Thanks be to God.
rise in body or in spirit as we sing, Precious Lord, take my hand. Precious Lord, take my hand, lead me on.
Steadfast love, watch over your beloved community. May we who share in these holy mysteries find comfort and challenge in your reign, where there is one flock and one shepherd, one fierce mama hen keeping us under her wings. We ask this in the name of Jesus Christ, the risen one. Amen. I invite you to remain standing as we invite. You've got to help me get through this one. and if... Oh God, we give such thanks for Catherine. And we trust that your Holy Spirit is being poured out day by day upon this precious, beautiful sister. And we know that you have walked with her through the shadow of death. You have walked with her through struggle and through pain, and we ask that you now walk with her forward. that you walk so near to her as she engages this journey of healing, of wholeness, of joy, of coming so fully back to the beautiful, incredible, wonderful daughter that you have created. Catherine, as you go from this place, do not forsake the breaking of bread. Practice resurrection and seek the peace of the places and people that God will put in your place. God bless you with love and with healing. God send you with courage and meet you with hope. And God lead you in the ways of liberty. Go forth, dear friend, with our blessing and our prayers. Go forth in the power of the risen Christ. Go forth as a herald of the coming kingdom. Go forth and bear witness in all you do to the love of God, the redemption of Jesus, and the incredible comfort and challenge of the Holy Spirit. Let us also bless one another before our closing song. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The blessing of the Good Shepherd, source of all being, eternal Word and Holy Spirit, go with you now and remain with you always.
Amen. Amen.
All right, let's sing our way home.
The days will come when I'll stand by your side. I'll show you my face and my
God will respond to the cry of the poor. practice resurrection, tend the garden, love the beautiful shepherd and mother hen, and serve people and God's creation. Amen. Amen. Thanks be to God. Hallelujah.